You're watching the free version of Silhouette Essentials. For projects and footage, head to borisfx.com for the premium download. Right, so now we are ready to start doing our rotoscoping. But if you're new to all of this, one big question remains. What is rotoscoping? Well, rotoscoping is a tool we use for drawing shapes to extract, isolate, or affect a portion of an image. And that's what we want to do with this hand, of course. So we're going to use Silhouette's Roto node to draw up a series of shapes that follow the hand, the fingers, and the arm. Now, this can be a ton of work, but I'm going to show you a few little techniques how we can make this a little bit easier on ourselves. If you do want to go deeper into rotoscoping, then we have a separate Silhouette course that focuses solely on Roto. But in this part, we're only going to get in as deep as we need to create up our shape layer. On the left-hand side, we have our tools. And these tools are contextual. So different nodes will display different tools in this area. With that being said, many of the tools are common between different nodes. With Roto, though, we have a few different categories. Up at the top, we have three shapes that are concerned with manipulating or moving shapes or points that we already have on the screen. We don't have anything drawn yet, so these tools aren't going to be useful for us. The next three tools are about us drawing shapes ourselves using different types of splines. Again, this is a little bit beyond the scope of this current course, but we have B splines, X splines, and Bezier splines. The next three tools are again about drawing shapes, but they're doing things in a more automated way. So we have our magnetic freehand tool, or we have our square shape tool, or our circle shape tool. The next button brings up our motion trackers, and this is a huge topic and obviously one we're going to go deep into because motion tracking is the number one way helping to cut down the time you spend doing roto work. And then we have our multi-frame and our roto overlays, which are more sort of advanced things that we'll come to as we need them. The first thing I'm going to do though is draw our initial shape. And I'm going to draw this on the first frame. I don't have to draw this on the first frame, but the first frame is where we have a good view of our object we want to track in. It's also big and in focus. Now, instead of making one shape across the entire hand and arm, a good technique is to break things down into smaller areas. And the reason for that is that not every part of the hand is moving in the same way. So the fingers push and pull in one sort of way, the main back of the hand moves in a slightly different way and compresses down in a different way. And the forearm itself also moves differently as it's being warped and pushed and pulled by the other hand as well. So by breaking a complex shape up into smaller, simpler areas, we're actually going to be saving a lot of time in the long run. So I'm going to make my first shape and I'm going to use a circle tool. So click on the circle. And I'm going to come, click, and drag to create our first shape. And when I let go, we have our shape created. We can see this down in the object list called Circle 1. When I finish drawing my shape, the tool snaps back to our arrow tool, which is actually called the Reshape tool. And the Reshape tool lets us take points and move them around either individually, or if we have multiple points selected, we can move those together here. And Reshape lets us manipulate individual points. If we don't want to manipulate individual points, we can come up to this tool here, which is our Transform tool. And this lets us change the shape as a whole. So if I move over my shape, you can see the cursor changes its icon, which means we're going to be moving this around, changing the position. If I go to the outside of the bounding box and go to the corners here, I can scale the shape up and down. If I hold down Shift, we can scale proportionately, X and Y. If I go to the middle of the edge of the bounding box, I can choose to scale only vertically or only horizontally. But again, if I hold down Shift, I can scale proportionately X and Y, no matter which of these areas I am clicking on. One other manipulation that we can do with this bounding box is if we hold down the Control key or the Command key on Mac, and again, you can see the cursor changes. If I do this in the center of the bounding box, I can distort my shape using a skew or shearing motion. And if I go to the corners of the bounding box with Control or Command on Mac held down, I can do a rotate. Very nice. And one final thing, if I hold down the Alt key or Option key on Mac, I can then do a distort, which works a little bit like a corner pin distortion. So if I select any of the corners there, we're distorting this up. And if we go into the center of the bounding box, again, we get that same skew as we had when we were holding down the Control or Command key. And when we start to do animation with this, I'm going to be holding down the Alt key a lot. So be prepared for me saying Alt click, almost an unimaginable number of times. Now, when I'm breaking up my shape, I'm looking to see the smallest number of shapes that I can break this into. There's no point adding in a lot of complexity here if we don't need it. So if we take a look at the forearm now, and let's have a look at the movement there, can I get away with one shape on the forearm? Well, I think I can. I'm going to use the circle tool again, even though this might not be the most optimal tool for this particular shape, and I'm going to draw a little sausage. As before, it brings us back into the reshape tool, and as before, I'm going to move into the transform tool. I'm going to alt click or option click just to bring those points relatively in the right position. And then let's go back to the reshape tool and see what that's done. And here are the four points that are making up the circle. In fact, the fourth point is just outside of the screen. So here's another keyboard shortcut for you. If I press and hold space, I can pan around the viewer. And as soon as I let go of space, it's going to stop panning. I don't even have to click. I can just move my mouse or pen around, and that's enough to move the viewer. We can see the shape isn't quite matching up to the arm yet, so let's add some more points into it. How do we do that? Well, we have the reshape tool selected, so we can do a lot of stuff with the reshape tool. If I hold down the Alt or Option key, again, our cursor changes and it shows us the arrow with a little plus sign. So now if I click on the line, I get another control point, and I can bring that control point where I need it to be. If you're used to something like the pen tool in Photoshop, then this style of shape creation might seem a little bit strange to you. And let's see why. If I go into Preferences and go to Shape, the primitive type for our shapes is currently X-spline. And we can change this, of course, to B-spline or Bezier. The spline type that is used in the pen tool in Photoshop is a Bezier spline. So it means every control point has three elements. It has the center control point, plus it has weighting on the left and right side. That's a lot of control to juggle, especially when we're animating. That's why I recommend when we're doing organic roto, we use one of the other spline types. Personally, I prefer X-spline, but I know that many people and companies prefer B-splines instead. But both X-splines and B-splines work in, you know, relatively similar sorts of ways. They have one control point, and if we hold down Alt or Option again and scrub left and right, we can control the tension on that control point. So we have things super relaxed, or a very sharp edge here, or again, moving back to a more relaxed area. If I right click on this, we can change this to Corner, Cardinal, B-spline, or center. And center just moves us into the middle of the control points before and after. Okay, so let's add in a couple more points just to create this shape. So Alt click to add a control point, and I can move this one in. Alt click again. And then we'll have our finished shape for this. Now it's very important to make sure we have some overlap between the shapes, because we don't want to accidentally sort of leave just a fine line running between the shapes. So I'm always quite generous with the overlap that I have with the shapes here. And finally, I'm going to come in and make shapes for my fingers. This time I'm not going to use a circle tool, I'm going to use one of the other shape generation tools. And we have the same as we saw in the preferences, we have B-spline, X-spline and Bezier. I'm going to stick with X-spline here. I'm trying to make as few points as possible along here. And I'll do the same for all the other fingers. Basically adding points at the joints, making sure there's overlap, and keeping these shapes as simple as possible. And I do have the thumb up here as well. And if we look at the movement of the thumb, I can see that this is probably going to react better to keeping this as two separate shapes. The angle of the thumb means that the thumb tip and the meat of the thumb are moving at different times. So just to keep things simple, I'm going to make two separate shapes here. X-spline for the thumb tip, boom, boom, boom. And I'll use my circle tool one more time, just on the thumb itself. There we go. So now we have our initial shape and we can start to move it. But we're not going to do that now. We're going to take another break. When we come back, we're going to look at how we can make life easier for ourselves. So we're going to look at organization and how we view our shapes. So join me in the next section.